I decided to extend this project further and study Christian broadcasting in India, particularly in the context of Chennai, because Chennai is the heart of Christian expansionism in India. Literally thousands of churches. And when I went there, first, the interesting thing is that when you talk, these churches are not neither the mainstream churches nor the Orthodox churches, but they are what are called the Catholic Church, what are Protestant churches. They are part of what's called the Pentecostal movement, the Neo-Pentecostal movement. And there's very little study that's been done in India on the strength of Pentecost. Okay? There's a lot of anecdotal evidence. Very little proper research has been done on them. But in actuality, they are a huge, huge group. In fact, vying in terms of numbers with the mainstream ones. Okay? So there's a sense in which Pentecostalism is the global face of Christianity. So whether it's in Guatemala or Brazil or anywhere else, they made a huge dent. Okay. So in other words, you have the Catholic Church in retreat in Guatemala and places like Brazil and even in India. I was reading a report in Kerala, 2007 report of the church in Kerala. The heart, the key place in Kerala for the Syrian Christians is places like Kottayam, Tiruvalla, Kumbana, all these kinds of places. And there too, there's been a change. You know, mainstream churches are on the retreat, the Mahatma Church, the Syrian Christian churches, and you find a lot more of these groups coming in. And there are some phenomenally wealthy individuals attached to these New Pentecostal churches. Okay? Now, one of the interesting things about the study was that I got into it and then I realized that one thing that's happening in India is this God market business. Neoliberalism has affected religion as well. Okay? There is this phenomenal God market here. Okay? And the commodification of religion in massive ways. When you look at Hinduism, in so many ways, that's happening. And also if you look at Christianity. Catholics, for example, they're outsourcing, from the West, they're outsourcing prayers. So there are Christian priests in Kerala who pray on behalf of someone and they get paid for it. That kind of stuff is happening in a big way also in the church. But a recent book by Meera Nanda on kind of nexus between what she says is the state, the market, and Hinduism is an interesting book. It's called The God Market, How Globalization is Making India More Hindu. And she says that this is the rush hour of the gods in India. These guys coming in, it's like a supermarket, you pick and choose kind of stuff. And this is, this is something that you need to kind of keep in mind when we talk of Neo-Pentecostalism. Because Neo-Pentecostalism is really rooted in the market economy. Okay? And even the theologies, in a sense, deal with the market. They've got something called prosperity theology, the health and wealth gospel. And in that, it's pretty clear to them. It's like, if you're wealthy, it's blessing to you. If you're not wealthy, you're trying to become wealthy. And you can do that by becoming a very Christian. And that's the kind of thinking that they have. Now, one of the, there are very distinctive, features of Pentecostalism and Neo-Pentecostalism. One is this whole thing called glossolalia. Glossolalia is speaking in tongues. You have it in some of these churches. You have, strong accent on spirit possession and healing. And things like that. Gifts of the Spirit, when they put their hands and they sing, and they're exuberant, all that kind of stuff. And there are a variety of churches in this tradition, from mega churches in Tamil Nadu, like the Assamese Lord Church there, which you can have about 30,000 people attending services there on a Sunday, to a small house church. So there's a huge variety, massive loads of them. And one of the interesting things about these guys is that there is what is called the in many of these Neo-Pentecostal ways of thinking, a homology between the entrepreneur and God, because both are creators. God is a creator in the larger sense, entrepreneurs are creators of wealth, the two come together in some kind of fashion. And there are those who take this this strong free market view, that we live in a competitive religious economy, and that really needs to be dealt with in terms of supply and demand. Okay? there's a demand for something like this in the times in which we live. And this is just a picture that I took. I went for one of these crusades. It's part of the God market. You know, everything is for sale, you know, the rosaries, this, that, you name it, books, videos. But it's much bigger than this. You can go to some of these Christian bookshops in Chennai to find a huge rack of videos, this, you know, all sorts of products. And of course, you can also go on the website. You can go on God.com and things like that. You can buy anything under the sun. And these things are sold because they are supposedly anointed. And that's the word that Jesus gives you. They're blessed, you use it, and you prosper. It's a simplistic kind of a, you know, ideology behind it, but it's really good. Now, there's a religious scholar by the name of Harvey Cox, and he said that Pentecostalism is really a religion made for travel. It's true. And if you look around Pentecostalism, you can see the ways in which it's kind of fitting into a globalized reality, whether it's in the Philippines or South Africa or India. You've got the malls are there, you know, it's part of their space, and you know, a little slum somewhere is also their space. So the way in which they kind of embrace different spaces is fascinating in different parts of it. So you've got, for example, in India, Chennai, you've got worship in some of those malls. You can go to a place like Abhirami Mall, where there's a group called Powerhouse. They you know, walk there on Sunday kind of thing, that kind of thing. So again, very different from the mainstream churches. The mainstream churches tend to be very traditional in terms of the outlook. These guys tend to be a lot more modern, post-modern, whatever you want to call them. So a little more, a few more pictures. Now that's the New Life Assemblies of God Church in Chennai. It's massive. It's massive. They've got three floors. And you know, on a Sunday, 30,000 people, you know, visit that kind of church. And they're also a big vote bank as well. These are powerful figures in their own. This is the Believers Church in Kerala. And this is by a very interesting guy by the name of K.P. Yohanan. And K.P. Yohanan has consistently been on top of the FCRA clearance list in terms of the monies that he gets in India. So it regularly tops 100 crores a year. And much of this money goes into church planting in Odisha and Gujarat and all these kinds of places. And he's big into radio and television. And he's got massive interest in radio, beaming from the outside. And now one of the issues with these kinds of characters is that, you know, given the fact that community radio licenses are being given, they've already sent feelers. Because if you look at community radio in many parts of the world, the Christians are involved in the people, right? So the same thing is happening here. I came for a licensing session, a community radio licensing thing in Puthukottai, which is about 2 hours from here. And I met this guy who had come, you know, for his license. And I chatted with him, he said, I asked him, which, you know, where do you guys, where do you come? He said, I belong to an organization called Karnataka for Christ. Why is he doing that kind of stuff? But you know, they've already started getting this, you know. And I think that, you know, the government actually has loosened policies with respect to community radio. Now religious groups can actually get involved in it. So you know, there's going to be all sorts of issues in the next couple of years. So that's K.P. Yohanan's church. It's a lovely church, actually. It's beautiful churches, you know. And he's really, you know, there's a contestation, big contestation with groups like him in the mainstream churches. This is the Chennai Hope Festival. This was just about a month ago, held in Chennai again. The key guy here was Franklin Graham. And Franklin Graham was the son of Billy Graham. Billy Graham was an original evangelist, that's it. But this guy's a bit of a hardcore guy. He famously actually, you know, there's a picture of him on top of a tank going back there with the troops. And that's it. That's it. Okay. So there is this massive, you know, Christian presence, I think, in many parts of it. Of course, you might say that, you know, it's not as visible as, say, some of the people like, say, Sri Sri Ravi Shankar or something. But you know, they are massive scale. I mean, if something, you know, an event like this attracted at least 5 to 6 lakhs people. So it's a big, big event over 4 days, kind of, you know. And there's products being sold, people being endorsed. These are videos, you know, these are streamed on the net. You know, all the television guys are there. So it's a massive event. So if you look at the reasons for the rise of Pentecostalism, many people are dissatisfied with the mainstream church today. Mainstream, especially the ecumenical movement. large movements that stand for social justice. They're pretty tired. You know? They want certainty. Many people want certainty in their lives. And these guys give them that certainty. It's pretty clear. You give your time, you go up. The heaven comes. It's a very clear kind of message. And people buy it. There's also this perceived issues with the secularization of society, which we also do. Again, very close to some of the fundamentalists in other groups. They're also not happy with the way in which society is being secularized. This moral decay is very much like Ram Sen, the guys who were on, kicking women up in pubs and all that kind of stuff. It's very similar, although these guys don't go that far. They have a huge problem with the ecumenical movement. The ecumenical movement is the large umbrella body that really deals with social justice issues. They have a very strong, what is called a liberation theology kind of approach to life. And these guys have a huge problem. In 2006, there's a group called the Pew Study on Media and on Religion. The Pew guys do all these global surveys. And they did a 10-nation study of Pentecostalism, including India. And they came up with some interesting statistics. 90% of the guys they interviewed were against homosexuality, against divorce, against all sorts of things, as a family values-based kind of approach to Christianity. So this, the other interesting thing about these guys, and here is where maybe the mainstream churches can learn from them. There's a very strong emphasis on morality. The mainstream churches tend to be guys with book. They believe in the book, text-based kind of stuff. These guys are very old. And if you go to one of their services, very exuberant worship, they let people express themselves kind of stuff. And in a sense, if you look at the history of Pentecostalism, in India, for example, in early days in Kerala, most of the people who became Pentecostals were Dalits. Because they were given that kind of a space to express themselves, which they couldn't in the mainstream churches. So there is that kind of a, you could say, I think that it's progressive, there's only giving people voice. They also give women a lot of space, voice. Some famous evangelists today are women. So this emphasis on morality, therefore, this primal speech is extremely important. The other thing that they do, and again this is interesting, is they recognize the power of Satan. Many of these people are Pentecostals to be converts from little traditions, and they bring those little traditions along with them. So there's a very strong, in Chennai, this belief in Bay. Bay is like Satan, right? And the power of Jesus Christ to get Satan along. So if you look at many of their programs on television and stuff, it's about these kinds of things. It also deals with people's needs. At a grassroots level, there are people with all sorts of issues and problems. And these people cater to those kinds of needs. And I think mainstream churches are going to rush. They don't deal with these kinds of issues that people have nowadays. So, what makes these guys very distinct? They've got a fantastic structure, many of these big churches. You may have a huge church in the middle of Bangalore, maybe in Bombay or something, but they reach out right down to grassroots. So they have these little cells, and they've got people going there and praying for local people, supporting them, providing them when their people are in need. That is what has made them successful as a church. So they've got a fantastic grassroots. They're very strategic in terms of negotiating with globalizing audiences. So they've got, many of these, say the Assemblies of God churches that you have here, they've got strong connections to global mission. And all their guys are in the Midwest, in the US. There's a lot of people, a lot of missionary folk from here, from India. And then their worship styles are very interesting. I think it was Bollywood. And one of the things that I found interesting, but there are lots of born again Bollywood stars who are part of this whole this deal, who are part of the Pentecostal kind of movement. This guy called Benedict Vijay, this guy called Johnny Abraham, from America. And these guys front them, and they sing similar kinds of songs. And they are huge hits. So they've used Bollywood very, especially singers, very well in terms of some of the approach. And then what they're pushing for, I feel, is this kind of singular Christian identity. They have a kind of a triumphalistic understanding of what Christianity is. And that identity they believe is for all Christians. But it's intensely problematic because there are all sorts of Christians in this country. My Christian identity is very different from theirs. And then there's accent on family values. So if you look at Pentecostals in India, you find that you can have subaltern Christians, you know, poorer kind of Christians, but you can also have pretty wealthy Christians. They've got some interesting, you know, their strategies. For example, they have special worship programs for the IT sector. Okay? Because, you know, there's a huge IT crowd here. And this is only done in places like, you don't find this anywhere. Bangalore's got this very strong. They've also got a symbolic and real presence in the space of globalization, like I said, in malls, they've got massive real estate. You know, these, you know, in India, I mean, Chennai, some of these new Pentecostal preachers own real top real estate. They're really wealthy. They also got these family-based ministries. Many of these kinds of groups are family-based. So, for example, Jesus calls, belong to a guy called Dinakaran. And Dinakaran's whole family is involved in evangelization. And they're very strongly present on television where they push this kind of family. And I really think that, you know, they've been involved in the creation of a Christian Ummah, like the Islamic Ummah, that is beyond class, caste, and other kind of social marks. So, there are key contestations in India. Between the sect and the church, and there's this French social philosopher by the name of Pierre Bourdieu, who's talked about these kinds of contestations. And in the old days, Max Weber, who was another person who did a lot of religion in the 18th century, also wrote about these kinds of contestations between the priest. You can say the priest stands for the mainstream church of the prophet of these days. Okay. Major contestations over Christian mission. Okay. What is Christian mission? Very difficult to reign these days. Because they believe that, you know, they have an undertaking from God. So whenever there was a, you know, whenever there's major conflagration in North India or South, and where the mainstream church is trying to have a conversation with these guys, but they won't sit for more than half an hour conversation. Because they believe that they've been sent propagate the gospel and promote folks and all things. That is problematic. And then there's this contestation online as well. They spend a lot, and some of their websites are really good. And if you want to get sociological information on, for example, indigenous people and all the rest of it, you'll find much better information on their sites than on some of our government websites. You know, they do their work, they put a lot of money into it. So this is the kind of stuff. This is statistics from the Hindustan Bible Institute on the impact of radio and other types of evangelism. And so you can see, you know, how many Hindus, how many Christians, how many Muslims, how many being saved, kind of. And this is commonplace. This is, you know, you can go to other, you know, any number of organizations and get this kind of data. Okay? So this therefore is a reality in India. And this needs to be taken seriously. I really think that before you point fingers at the other fundamental is you've got to deal with the guys in your own fold. So, okay. Now, the interesting thing about New Pentecostals, again, unlike the mainstream church, they are real believers in the media. Okay. Which is why, for example, tele-evangelists in the US, they tend to be, you know, big in the media. They have no problem with the media. In fact, for them, this is essential. This is, so every new technology is a gift from God. Because you can use to propagate the gospel. Okay, that's how they look at all technology. There's television, then the internet now. Okay. And really that core media, whether it's in India or elsewhere, is broadcasting. And like I said earlier, there is an issue with community radio licensing. With these guys getting into it. There's also an issue with FM radio. You know, FM radio too, there are a number of stations here who don't have content and who are selling content to these guys. Okay, so they're getting into this in smaller venues. Another very interesting thing about these guys is this, what I call the mobile commodity form. And that is, certain types of products are blessed in the church and people buy these and take it home and watch them. example, could be believed. These are mobile commodities. There's a kind of flow between the church and the home and the church. Okay. Now, one good example of this, two good examples is My Hope Project and the Left Behind series. The Left Behind series is a classic piece of work. This was done by two people called Beverly and Tim Hayes, and they're based in Denver. Okay. And this whole series of books and films is based on a particular verse in, I think it's Luke's Gospel or Matthew's Gospel. It says that in the last days, some people will be taken away and some people will be left behind. Okay. This whole thing is in there. They've sold millions of these copies of these books. And these books and DVDs are available in our local evangelical stores. Okay. And they're fascinating to watch because it's a complete, it's apocalyptic imaginary thing, these kinds of programs. And people buy it. They sold millions and millions of these kinds of programs. And it's interesting because in the US, what's happening now is that these kinds of projects, these kinds of films are not released to theaters, film theaters. They actually license to churches. Okay? So for example, 300, 400 churches will be licensed to show this kind of film. So there they have huge audiences. And of course, one of the issues with all this, when we talk of cultural politics, of these kinds of groups, is that today in the US you can actually live within a Christian economy. You can take a mother can take, get up in the morning, put on some Christian music, take the child to Christian school, go to an exercise place which is also Christian, get a loan from a Christian organization, buy a car from a Christian organization, this kind of stuff. And there's no reason why these kinds of things can't be exported to other parts of the world. So it's when we talk of the media, we need to actually connect it to some of those larger things that are happening. Okay, change in the cultural change that is happening. Okay. And this kind of commodity form being part of this culture. So in India, if you look at television in India, there are five types of Christian television. There's occasional space on Doordarshan, okay, for Christian stuff. Then you've got transnational channels, and they vary. You get some channels in Bangalore, some in Chennai, some in Hyderabad, etc. But the big ones are God TV, Miracle Net, and Daystar TV. And I did some work with Daystar TV, God TV is very interesting, is based in Jerusalem. Okay. And if you look at the very kind of postmodern, visualization on God TV, so that itself is pretty attractive to the younger generation. But if you go behind and look at the message, it's fascinating. Because there are strong Christian Zionists. In other words, these are people who very strongly believe that the Holy Land is for the Jews and the Christians. Okay? There's no space for Muslims in the world. And that comes across very strongly in their program. So, if you guys have problems sleeping at night, then you've got God TV on, watch it. Because I can tell you, you will learn a lot on how these guys propagate their Christianity. Then Christian programming is variety, is available on a variety of secular TV channels. Like Raj TV, ZTV. And so this is people like Joyce Meyer and Ken Copeland and Benny Hinn and all these kinds of characters available in these kinds of channels. And then you've got increasingly a lot more indigenous standalone Christian channels. And there are huge numbers of them, and every year they increase. At the same time, the other ones also increase. You've got Hindu channels, etc. But the Christian ones are also increasing. You've got things like Angel TV, Jeevan TV. It's pretty, if you've got 5,000 rupees, you can go on TV, basically. So you have all these small-time evangelists getting on television with their little message. And then, of course, Jesus calls his brother Dinikran's outfit, and they're very involved in internet-based Christian programming as well. Now, this is an area that the state has huge problems trying to regulate. They open this market up, and there's nothing they can do. Right? With radio, I think they are kind of a lot more careful. But it would seem that even in radio, the space for these kinds of groups is basically. Now, this was taken at the Chennai Hope Festival, and one of the stalls was basically, you know, about Christian television. So it says God's blessing via satellite. You can actually get, you know, basically 20 stations, 20 television channels that you can actually get a phone from. That's all it is. Here's another guy. He's Pastor Chelladure, Sam Chelladure. He's one of the key guys in Neo-Pentecostal movement, very strong prosperity theology. His church is in Chennai. And I attended 2 weeks ago, I attended his one of his services, just to check it out. The whole thing is televised. Right? So it's a televisual experience, spectacle basically. And every 10 minutes they would say, you know, the guys online can press this button to submit your type kind of thing. There's a lot of money being made. And but there were, you know, three big cameras on stage. The whole thing is a televised thing. And that's more about the kinds of things that is openly available. It's the kind of thing that's on their website. Okay. And you know, when you come to the last bit of all kinds of chains and bondages, that's a kind of euphemism for other religions. The fact that all these guys are, you know, chained by Satan in other religions. That's a picture of Jolly Abraham, the guy on the right. He's one of the born again singers. And that's Vijay Benedict. And this particular event was something called Every Tribe and Every Tongue. This was held in 2008 in Chennai. And Chennai seems to be the place where these kinds of things are. And isn't this, he brought together about 130 tribes from India who had been missionaries. Okay. There were about 30,000 people there, 5,000 people. And what's, for me, because I do work on fundamentals, what is interesting is that on stage you had all the luminaries, including all the political leaders, from Chidambaram to the BNP guy, on stage. Right? And this is why it gets problematic. Because I think they see these guys as vote banks. Congress standing for minorities, that kind of stuff. This is the opposite. Here's another one. All the Senate. All the bankers got a share. You have people like Ninan coming here to do his big speech. See, this book that I did was deals with Christian fundamentalism. And again, look at that t-shirt. The next t-shirt actually, picture that. This is being sold at the Chennai Hope Festival. Warriors of Christ. Right? That's that kind of imagery that comes across in some of their material. Like I said, you know, you can distinguish between soft and hard types of fundamentalism. These guys tend to be soft. They don't want killing people. But they also strongly believe in the inerrancy of scriptures, a literal understanding of the gospel, strong commitment to proclamation. Premillennialism is the last days. They have a strong belief in the last days. That they are, it's from the point that you've got to behave, to turn to Christ because the last days are at hand. Very strong mixing of religion and politics. And that's happening, of course, mainstream churches also do that. But increasingly, you see the Neo-Pentecostal group is very involved in mixing religion and politics. So look at, for example, the late Vaishar Reddy. Good example. Vaishar Reddy was, a Seventh-day Adventist. Very committed Christian. And one of the things that he wanted to do, tried to do, was to, you know, we've got, in the Indian government subsidized people to go to the Hajj. Right? Huge range of money. So he decided that if it's a Muslim man, it's a Christian. So he tried to push for a subsidy scheme for, you know, to help Christians go to the Holy Land. There's nothing like that. You know, the Bible doesn't have anything to do with that. You know? So, and of course, he had huge issues in Tirupati. Because, you know, there's a lot of interference in the temple class. And all that. Many of them believe in a strong, many of them are separatists. Many of these Christian families. Especially the guys in Northeast India. Who are, you know, who are also involved in fighting against the Indian state. They tend to be strongly Baptist, but very strongly separatist. And then they have this very strong belief that they've been elected to do this. Christians are an elect kind of minority. They're put on earth for a purpose. And so in other words, they're the foot soldiers for Christ. Like I said, you know, if you have time, have a look at some of these programs. Christian Broadcasting Network, there's a crazy guy called Pat Robertson there. He's a well-known figure. Recently, when the Haiti earthquake happened, he said that there was a rock of God kind of thing. And these people are, you know, pretty strong here. The other issue that I found very interesting was that many of these criticisms are on the minority schools. You get it? In other words, when they go to Capitol Hill in the US and stuff like that, they're representing all Christians. Mm-hmm. Okay. And that's where they, you know, their spiel is about persecution, about this and that, about Christianity, nothing about what they do in the context of those kind of violence. So, from a, you know, in terms of further research, that is why we have a conversation. I think there is a need to deal with the structures from a political economy kind of perspective. Because, you know, because the studies people, many of them say, look, you know, forget about the structures, deal with the negotiation, meanings, and stuff. It's true, you need to do that. But at the same time, I think there are these massive structures. You know? There's lots of things in the US, and those things can need to be fruitfully explored. In the US, you had studies on televangelism, things like that, over the last 20 or 30 years. In the South, we don't have any of that. And we need more studies. At the same time, I think we need to, you know, we need to study reception. You know, this whole business of mediation of meaning. How do people engage with this kind of material? You know, what's their take? Why is there so many of them? Why is it that this kind of a message is a lot stronger than any other type of message? And then, you know, this whole business of the embrace of new churches, how they embrace the city is fascinating. It's about, you know, urban cultures, you know, and the way these guys have gone and taken over, you know, areas of the city and made it their own. Again, fruitful areas. And finally, I think there's one business of, you know, there is contestation with other fundamentalism. That's true. No question. Okay. The Christian fundamentalism and Hindu guys are up against each other. But at another level, you know, there are lots of correspondences. It's not as watertight as you think it is. When I was doing my field work, Jesus calls it, you know, I happened to ask the communication director there whether they had a tough time on the behaviors of power. And he said, look, Pradip, we know how these guys work. Advani has a public persona. He's got to be anti-minority. But we know that he's got a private persona that we deal with. Okay. And this fellow took out a picture and showed Advani in private. Yeah, it's that kind of stuff. When Benny Hinn goes to Bombay, Mumbai, he has to meet with the Shiv Sainis because he wants to get space in a municipality. How does he get that? Money changes hands. This kind of, you know, in other words, at that level, there's a kind of, you know, close connection between many of these fundamentals. It's not as watertight as you think it is. So I just leave it. Any questions?
Yeah, can you tell us more about the program
they
have for IT people in Bangalore?
I personally don't know, but it's available. If you go to their website, if you go to Pastor Mohan's website, you'll find it's Assemblies of God Churches. Yeah, Assemblies of God Churches. There's a New Life Church in Chennai, and there's one here as well. Now, they've got very specific ministries for IT professionals. What they do there, how they convince them that they should all turn it as I don't know. But that's something that we can teach. But it's interesting how this kind of segmented approach to audiences. It's not only the general audience, but also the segments of interest. And you know, see, at one time, Pentecostal Church is only there with the poorer castes and classes. That's one of the things. You know, they deal with everyone. And that's the kind of significant thing that we need to explore. And keep the whole lot together. Yeah.
This is a fascinating talk. Thank you. I want to ask about the idea of rationality you were talking about, especially how you relate it with the Weberian rationality, and then Beth had talked about the relationship between capitalism and the Protestant. Yeah. So this is an old connection, right? Relationship between rationality and capitalism and Christianity. So here you were talking about how these new Pentecostal churches are kind of why there is alienation from the mainstream church. Because but still there is an issue with capitalism.
Absolutely.
Where you know, there is a lot of commodification, media. So media revolution is still very the other rationality and it's very what's the break?
Interesting point. If you go to some of the churches in the Northeast, you find that they begin with the drum. This is their old tradition. And then at some point the whole thing becomes rational. Takes and this and that. They bring the two together. And they keep the church, because of the fact that they bring the two together. These guys, what's interesting is, on the one hand, they are very strong on, they don't, theology is very limited. Look at Pentecost theologies. When as compared to what's happening in mainstream, the accent really is on this direct experience. Okay, so it's the exuberant, the part of the hands, all that kind of stuff. So they do, on the one hand, it's not in that sense, based on this kind of text-based theological understanding of the faith. You basically have an experience of God. In that sense, it's like, you would say, like, bhakti movements, direct experience. On the other hand, they're very Catholic, and they bring the group together in a very good way. So, like I said, for example, this ministry that I went to 2 weeks ago, church called the Apostolic Tabernacle Fellowship, where there were 3 week calendars. And the whole thing was mediated. It completely was mediated. There was nothing else there. It was just televised event. Everyone, all of us, the audience, in some kind of a television studio. And the entire thing was a special made for television. Okay, where the accent was on giving money, praying for you, giving money. So yes, they brought those two things.
Yes,
very different kind of. But we don't have it here. I never seen it in this place. political relationship with us. So you're right, there is that diversity.
Into a spectacle which can then be also used in cinema, in television, in other kinds of visual practices to reproduce the whole God and the subject kind of relationship, but also to then furthermore the spectator and the spectacle kind of relationship and so on. This, I haven't really found enough work which talks about the ways in which the internet, the aesthetics of simulation, which are not really those of representation, now come and mediate this entire scene where a lot of religious fundamentalist groups, and not just Christian ones but also Hindu and Islamic and so on, are using these particular technologies to revisit the whole notion of what is the relationship between then the priest and, for example, his flock, so to speak, or the God and his subjects and so on. I was wondering if you come across some instances like that in your research.
Not really. This is a whole area that needs to be explored. There are some people who believe that what we should be looking at is not religion and religion, but religion as religion.
Sure.
And that's an interesting take on this. And that's where your kind of thing comes
in. Yeah, so it's not basically to say that religion and something else, but technology is actually reproducing the aura that the religion
absolutely offers. I think that's happening in the basic. I mean, there's online religions.
I don't know if you know of this artist called Shilpa Gupta in India. She had an amazing project called The Blessed Bandwidth in the early 90s. I think it was one of the first art installations which deals with the whole question of worship. Where what Shilpa did was she carried the Ethernet cable onto Tirupati and Sabrimala and whatever, all the religious places, and she videographed the main priest blessing it and giving it the darshan of the God. And then she had a video of her connecting her computer with that particular Ethernet cable and then launching her website. So now in the comfort of your home, you can visit all these particular pilgrimages. And she had certificates from all these places, and this is officially blessed by this particular God, and that computer and that website on that server now have the franchisee of the God to give you that kind of...
And that's big now. She must have done it as like, you know...
No, it was one of the first radical experiments sort of
thing. That is the reality.
Yeah.
You can get your darshan online, and I've seen from Singapore Airport. I still remember these young now, free online stuff that you can do that stuff up there. And they're going to want young IT guys. They're all sending out their prayers and what they do to some favored kind of temple kind of thing. It's brilliant. And they're making a lot of money. Huge amount of money. So you put those sites on television, these Hindu sites.
Yeah.
They give you, it's like market. You name the temple of your choice. You go there and you can do, you know, you can darshan, you can eat the prasad. Even prasad, they send the prasad by post or whatever.
No, really?
They do all
that. I was just wondering if you come across something like that in India, especially with the fundamental church groups in terms of their usage of technology. Like you talked on a couple of things. You talked about, for example, those movies which are licensed to the church, which I think is absolutely fascinating that the church has the copyright holder for that cinema. And you talked about t-shirts which are being produced with certain slogans. But I was wondering if digitally that kind of dissemination of space is available, or is it something that we can now start researching into?
It probably needs research, because I really haven't come across much studies on these kind of things. And I'm sure a lot is happening. That's probably a fascinating area to work in. Interestingly enough, I think there's a very strong cultural studies kind of emphasis in dealing with these kinds of deviations and disruption. But India, there's not much in that. I mean, Meera Nanda's book is mainly on structures.
Yeah.
I also come from a political economy kind of perspective. I won't be doing disruption and deviation. But that's the kind of area that needs to be. A lot more needs to be done. Maybe you guys can have projects that we do.
I was thinking about Jesus' call on the biblical side, when you can actually put your prayer and then there's someone who prays for you and can you get feedback?
Immediate feedback.
Feedback about?
Annoying. When people who have got ill health or whatever, they submit their prayers. Mm-hmm. And they ask someone to pray for them.
The only
but everything is done for a fee. Yeah? Yes. This is not some free stuff.
The only website I know of which eventually got taken off was called freeconfessionals.com.
Yeah.
Officials of the church were technically available to you to confess online, and then they would give you certain kinds of penances back and so on. But there was a huge fight about it, and the Roman Catholic Church actually succeeded in getting it entirely removed from the internet. But
I mean, that's the interesting thing. I mean, the other thing, the way you deal with online is that there's a decentering of authority. That's happening. Because of this online. When you get started church online, there are not churches online. It's specifically only online. You worship online.
They don't exist in
reality. They don't exist in reality. Okay, there are all these kinds of possibilities. And that decentering of authority is an important kind of phenomenon. You know? For example, in these guys who want these sites that are anti-Islamic, kind of, or sites that are progressively Islamic. You know, they're all online. You know, and there are a lot of people going to those sites and getting some spiritual something from those sites. So those are exciting things.
Absolutely.
And we need that descent, all the time. Because otherwise these things get too strong. Too problematic.
And also a really old kind of compilation. I don't know the name of the group that submitted it to the American government, but a lobbying group representing Hindus in America did a compilation of hate speech from Christian groups.
That's
about 5 years old.
Just
a simple thing to do is to go to all those URLs and see what those URLs are doing today. Just update that report. Even though it starts off, the history of that report is a bad place, but I think we can use that as a database.
Yeah.
And that would be an interesting thing to do.
I think my most... Sorry, go ahead.
I wanted to ask about, you talked about the segmentation of the market and how they're addressing people differently. If they're approaching us as a family, then is there any special outreach for the older people, young people?
Everything, they were the whole works. They were the whole works. Youth is big. Youth is incredible. I mean, the fact that they deal with youth in so many different ways, in the language of their choice, in the music of their choice. I mean, one thing I've been impressed with is they've got good music. I mean, those are good bands. And they're not like the 20-year-old silly bands that we have. These are professional musicians who are also born-again Christians. To play good music. And I've always been surprised in seeing that kind of phenomenon. But that worship, praise and worship thing that these Pentecostal churches have had is now kind of slowly filtering into the mainstream churches. Okay. The reality is that mainstream churches are losing flock. And now they're adapting practices from the Pentecostal and neo-Pentecostal churches. For example, the Matoma church here, I know that on a Saturday at 5:30 they have a praise and worship. And that's basically a space for youth to come together, bring an evangelist of their choice, and then a music or whatever. Okay, and that's the way to keep the flocking, keep youth in place. So their influence in terms of music is phenomenal. And of course, remember that the gospel rock market is one of the biggest markets in the world. It's very close to the popular music market in terms of sales. And if you look at people like, you know, the Aussie lot.
Aussie
lot
is an Aussie group.
There's an Aussie called Hillsong. Hillsong is one of the world's biggest, you know, gospel rock kinds of people. They're from Sydney. Okay, they're all over the place. You can get it in one of the local shops.
Yeah, they're on my laptop.
But also doing the question of addressing age groups depending on technology. So most of these tests I noticed have the use of PowerPoint in the service.
Karaoke is kind of the same.
Yeah, and then at least the church on Hutchins Road, all the sermons are then archived on the website, and there's discussions based on the website, etc. If they also want to reach out to the older people, don't they get alienated if they begin to see things?
No, but that's not the only thing they do. But that's not the only thing that they do. Electric guitars have been accepted. Business is good. It's not that it's really good for the music to reach out to the music. The music is really good. So even the older or the soft music, the little harder one, all that kind of stuff. So there's a huge variety of music, silence. So there's not just one particular type of music for the youth alone. But the pastor's strategy is secondary. And that's the reason why they are so successful.
I have a question actually, which ties up with a lot of things that have been asked. You earlier asked, so development is inherent. But actually, that didn't come out of your talk at all, no? And I think for me, that was one of the most striking things if you compare what you said here with the traditional criticisms that say Mubufa has of the Christian church. Where it always says that they take advantage of poor people's bad state in life, and so they provide all these services, and through these services basically they buy people. Well, your argument was actually very different, because what you are saying is much more about a particular approach they have, which supposedly has to do with expression and spirituality, and which is where the old traditional development issue seems to have kind of disappeared into the background. Which made me think of your question, that maybe what they are appealing to is actually the desire created by capitalism, not the work ethic, but the kind of desire that you want to be part. Now, how do you do that? And then you create this kind of community in which you do all kinds of things that are kind of tied up with modernity, capitalism, the prosperity, the way it is defined now, and then that becomes part of the attraction. Where it also becomes easier then to paper over the actual differences, because that is another thing I found really striking. At least in the Catholic Church, there has been a lot of criticism for lower caste people still being treated as lower caste people, and you're saying they're actually creating an umma. Now, how can you gloss over these differences when you look at desire and not at actual differences?
I mean, this manufacture of desire is extremely important in some of the churches. Because, for example, the whole business of being blessed, which is a heart of prosperity, allows that blessing is for everyone. Okay? That blessing is not only for the rich guy, it's also for the poor guy. How do you get that person to that second stage? And that's an essential part of their whole culture function. Which is why the accent on money and prosperity, these are very strong accent. It is always there when you go listen to these guys. At least once you hear in some business of God blessing people. And yes, I mean, see, you can also look at another way. I mean, these churches, I think, are coping mechanisms for a lot of people, allowing them to integrate, live, and work in a positive way. They do. Whether we like it or not.
According to Marx, all religions.
Yeah. But these guys, unlike, for example, the mainstream churches, these guys are doing a much better job at that. So, I started out being very critical of these guys. And then I had Pentecostal friends in Burma, Brazil, but they're not all like that. There's another cycle. And they were telling me some of the past strategies. For example, they go into a barrier in Rio. Okay? And in a particular situation that the husband gets drunk, these boys, they can't convert. You convert the husband, you bring the money home, and the children get educated, all that kind of stuff. Immediate change. And that's what they started. They really have very focused kind of approaches to getting people to start their flocks. That thing is a success.
Also, I wanted to ask whether, Catholic and maybe Matuma institutions in North India, they are still more target, I mean, they are more development oriented or social justice oriented. Whereas Pentecostal institutions are not. Is that something
like that? Again, this is not what it is. So something they explained before. I have a critique about Madhavacharya always had an imaginative. Mm-hmm. He's writing on his own Naraman convention, 120-year-old convention, just 120th was last week.
Okay.
Okay. So they've got a very strong evangelical kind of focus. And they too, they too have these roving evangelists who go to Guruvayur and think, why are you go to Guruvayur to preach the gospel? Why don't you go somewhere else? It's there, so it's not again as watertight as it seems. Yesterday is not a development, that's true. Now some of it is good, but some of it was problematic. I mean, some of the stuff they do in Kannada, I think it's very problematic. They're converting folks in there. They've got a ministry now, complete Kannadigam kind of ministry, converting them, all that kind of stuff is happening in the ministry. So, I think people are learning from each other.
Question about that as well, though, because one thing I felt really uncomfortable with throughout the talk is what I felt was a constant slippage between Christianity, Pentecostalism, and fundamentalism. And it's actually a slippage. So, and your definition of fundamentalism is not very clear. In a way, I keep wondering, is it proselytizing that bothers you or fundamentalism? The idea that a group, if they can have as many radio stations or television stations as they want, if it's not my kind of thing, I do absorb, no? I do that with everything on TV that doesn't interest me.
Right.
The problem is, maybe they start to infiltrate spaces where I don't expect them and I don't want them there. But in general, people can do all kinds of things, no? Right. As long as there's spectrum, so that is one thing. Then the whole issue about, fundamentalism is a very strong word, and I actually have a real issue with the proselytizing, but it's a different issue and it's a different word. Also, within Christianity, to some extent, and in certain regions of the country, definitely Christians are under attack. I think politically it's a very difficult issue. There are also Christians, like I have to think now of what's the name again of that missionary guy in Orissa who got killed by the Indian. Who actually said, and his wife is still living in India, stands by that he never converted a single soul in his life. So there are people who live and work in very different ways. No? So, and I think if you're born in a Hindu family also, the chances that you are going to a Hindu school and that most of your friends are Hindu, and that's all actually even caste related, it's all very common. That doesn't make you fundamental.
Absolutely. No, I think I'm very clear on what I mean by fundamentalism. I'm not saying there's no slippage with Christianity. The Christianity is much wider, larger than Pentecostal. It's much larger. There is a slippage between the Pentecostal and the Neo-Pentecostals and in some fundamentalism. And that's a tough one to deal with. In my book, I say it's the guys who are using it specifically for a political agenda. Who I call them. It could be wise are ready for that. He's a fundamentalist. Many of these.
What is exactly the political agenda? With the Sankari Bhai, you can say, okay, they want India to be a genuine state. No?
Yeah.
With the conservatives in the US, even you can say there are people who want the US to be a Christian country.
Yeah.
No?
Yeah.
So that's very, it's about a capturing state power.
Absolutely. Yeah. And they do
have
that.
The agenda here?
So there is that.
How do we know
that? If you go to one of these rallies, that's where you realize that there is a difference. Whether it's, for example, a symbolic recapturing of the Indian flag, right? And basically that kind of thing that happens on stage, and I've seen it at least twice. Okay? So you do have those little moments when you can see a certain understanding, a creeping understanding that is there. And you can't say it's not there. Okay? Also, proselytization, it's a huge issue. Now, whether that's fundamentalist or not, we can have a conversation. But at the same time, you can say that it's fundamentalist. It's a fundamentalist ideology that leads to that kind of thing, right?
You know the discussions about agency of the poor and who gets to decide, no?
Again, these are tough issues. Who gets to decide?
Yeah.
Is it those poor people who are
right
there, who gets to decide to become a
fundamentalism is probably rooted, no? I think it would be good if you could include a few
for
more
me,
instances and
yeah.
indications
for me,
so that one knows what you're speaking
when
about.
When I talk about fundamentalism, it's about folks who believe in the inerrancy of scriptures, who believe in premillennialism, who are separatists in their understanding, and who also who use the media for proselytization and great commission, but who also play on the politics. You see, that's my understanding of fundamentalism, the Christian fundamentalism. So, you know, that's all I mean. And then you can contest it and say that that is not fundamentalism. That fundamentalism, that's why I say there's soft fundamentalism and hard fundamentalism. You see. And the hard fundamentalism is what guys go out there and think about and kill people and listen. But who says, even the same state, you know, that's a thing. You know, who says that they were not involved in the revolution? Who says? You know, so these are complex kind of issues. And there's a lot that's happening in India. Some that's, you know, a lot of Christians who do excellent work, I'm not saying all of them are like that. But there are lots of people also who are, I think, undoing the good work that many of these Christians are doing. And it's about those groups, right? Now, those groups can also contest this. So I think we need to have a conversation about this. And I think a lot more study needs to be done on these kinds of radicalized religions today. And you know, and minority fundamentalism. To say that there's only one type of fundamentalism here in this country, I think very important. Because anywhere you look, whether it's in Karnataka or Orissa, you'll find that wherever there's trouble, major trouble, there are also minority fundamentalists. Would you like that? Even that whole Orissa episode, depending on who you talk to. I was talking to, for example, an Oriya activist at the Civil Society Forum. And I asked him what happened there. He had this footage. He said that this is the law in that whole thing. So these are, you need to have conversations. You need to have, you know, proper conversations with the system. Any questions? But you know, I can take it to these things. They are, I mean, this whole business of fundamentalism and Pentecostalism, neo-Pentecostalism.
The argument would be that the Pentecostals are immune to caste, and they would say that way. And what about this managing ownership of the churches? Does that mean that the caste enemy would kick in at a later date, or is it too small and informal for caste to be longer? Because
I think that they are
the Catholics and Protestants, you know, how
you see, for example, you know, unlike the Markova Church, which has standalone churches for Dalits, only for Dalits, where Syrian Christians doesn't know. These guys don't have that problem. But we do at a certain level, you know, we can say that they are caste free. But I'm sure there are, you know, there are churches as well where the caste based in front and the poor guys in the back. That's also part of the reality. But you know, caste has got to deal with the mainstream church. Because that's where it's very prominent. So you go to the mainstream church in Andhra, or like, you know, this Mathama church in Kerala, yeah. And there's no point in trying to hide from the other. You've got to deal with it.
Any other questions?
Yeah, I think it's a very touchy subject.
I think
it's
the first time
everything
opened up like this.
And you know, popular, for example, only magazine in India that deals with these kind of things, Telka takes them on. At least three or four really good articles that come across Telka. None of the mainstream kinds of really, and you don't find a single thing in India today. Even some of the journals like EPW, you know, there's a lot of stuff from majority companies. Nothing that you come across.
There is a woman who's written a book about her starting point was actually the infiltration of the Sampradivad in rural areas in Chhattisgarh. But the way she ended up writing her book is also looking at the role of the Catholic Church in those areas in kind of making tensions worse and increasing the antagonism. So name is Pradip. I personally really like the book, so maybe you should have.
There are other guys as well, and there's Lionel Kaplan, who did work on Christian fundamentalism. Again, in Tamil. There's Susan Bailey, who's again in fundamentalism. So it's not as though it's new.
This is what Catherine Church. And she doesn't use the word
for me. So the online component is particularly important for us, because just like with the LTT, after the Sinhalese army moves in and swallows up those LTT commanders or family, then the LTT people come in and they cut up bodies, do more, take photographs, it goes on to common websites, heavy fundraising, it's a kind of cycle. So even with this, I bet there's a lot of this exaggeration.
Persecution stuff is a lot, there's a lot of it.
And I've heard from when I was in school 30 years ago, so, and it must have only got more shrill, right? Or more clever, I guess, these days. So, thanks so much.
Thank you.
Sorry, you didn't have a quick turnout, but it's great.